Welcome to Insight. Today we are chatting with Wendy Foster, President and CEO of Big Brothers Big Sisters of Massachusetts Bay. Big Brothers Big Sisters of Massachusetts Bay has been fostering professionally supported one-on-one friendships between young people and adult mentors for over 60 years. Wendy has generously agreed to share some of her experience with us. I'd like to thank you, Wendy, for joining us today.
Thank you, Mark. Happy to be here.
So talk about the extent of this organization, because it is quite large and it encompasses so many cities. Let's get a sense of the scale and then let's delve into your programs.
Sure. So Big Brothers Big Sisters is a national federation of independent affiliates. Each one is a separate 501c3 with its own chartered area, and we currently service most of the Massachusetts Bay Area, which goes up to the border of New Hampshire, down to the Attleboro Fall River area, and out to the Cape and Islands.
And there are 155 cities encompassed in
about that? 51% of the state's population resides in that service area.
And how many children are affected by the your programs?
Currently, we're serving just shy of about 2,000 children, with an estimated need of north of 30,000 children.
2,000 with an estimated need of close to 30. So that's about 8% of the population.
That's right.
And talk about your programs. How do Big Brothers Big Sisters put together their programs, and talk about the mentors and how you recruit those mentors?
Sure. So Big Brothers Big Sisters has been fostering, as you said, one-to-one relationships with caring adult mentors and children facing adversity for over 110 years. We've been doing that one thing and one thing really well. We've learned a lot about how to do it with tremendous outcomes for kids. Our average matches last over 3 years, and we recruit adults to participate in this endeavor from the general population. They have to be at least 18 years old and have to have a track record of forming great relationships in their lives, be it with loved ones, friends, colleagues, coworkers. If you can show that you can do that in your life, then chances are you're going to be very good at doing that with a child.
And what is the typical profile of a child who comes into your program?
So the typical child is living in a single parent household, typically with multiple siblings, and generally the family is living in an under-resourced community. And the family itself is generally under-resourced. Most of the kids are free and reduced lunch, living in poverty or close to the poverty line.
So so a child is entering into this program with a circumstance where there is need.
Absolutely.
And that person, that young person, is not necessarily receiving the kind of guidance or a certain type of guidance that would benefit them.
That's right. And so children who are at a deficit for adult support are generally not growing up with the kind of rails that we would want most kids to have, the understanding that you have to work hard for a long-term outcome, the importance of education, the importance of character and resiliency and perseverance. And even more important than that, these children are generally growing up in very isolated circumstances. If the neighborhood isn't safe, then their parent is doing the best they can to keep them safe by generally keeping them indoors. And many parents that we work with themselves didn't have this kind of guidance. So they don't know that what they could be doing for their kids under other circumstances is exposing them to the world beyond their neighborhood and providing them with a vision about what could be. So if you don't know that there are different kinds of career choices, if there are different opportunities, if adults can do a panoply of things, you don't aspire to that. You simply don't. So we're providing not only character building opportunity for children, support and guidance to grow up into healthy adults, but also a vision for what could be so that they can dream about a future that really fulfills their potential.
How do parents connect with your organization? I take it that most often it is the parents who are creating that initial outreach to you?
About 75% of the time, yes. And so our organization has to be in the communities that we want to impact, such that we're building trust and credibility with folks who live there. And it is generally then the parent who's calling us because they've heard about us, they've seen our advertising, other community organizations have recommended us. So we have to cast a very wide net in the communities we serve so that people can know about us and reach us.
So I try to envision a parent who is sitting there thinking about how they're going to address the needs of their child. And then they reach out to you. And what are they after? Are they after your time? Are they after resources? Are they after a perspective into the world for their child that they can't provide?
They're looking for a number of things, but I believe that most importantly, they want their children to grow up and have every possible opportunity available to them. And they realize that by themselves, without some help, they're not going to be able to provide that for their children. They may be worried that their kids are going to be influenced by the community around them in a negative way, and they want to avoid that. And they want their children to be around people who in their lives have succeeded, maybe have gone to college, at least have gotten an associate degree, are gainfully employed, are healthy, positive, active, contributing adults. And they want their kids to see that and know what that's all about.
What's the typical profile of your mentors? Do they come from the communities from which the children who benefit from the program are drawn as well, or they come from outside of those communities?
Sadly, so the children that we're serving are living in under-resourced communities, and that includes a dearth of adults. The adults who can are usually oversubscribed already. So most generally, the adults that work with the kids we're serving come from outside of their communities. And that makes it really interesting and challenging because the adults we work with are generally middle and upper middle class, well-educated, and frankly, predominantly Caucasian, while the families that we're working with are, again, living at or below the poverty line, and they're generally minority. So in our work, it's very important that we're able to help the volunteer and the child bridge the divide, the socioeconomic divide, the values divide, sometimes the cultural divide, for those relationships to be strong and to grow. So our mentors are generally coming from outside the community.
Who benefits more, the mentors or the mentee?
If you ask our mentors, they'll say they get much more out of the program than they possibly could be giving. I think both sides benefit equally in very surprising ways.
And how does the financing work? You're not paying your volunteers to mentor. So that is a tremendous resource of time that is placed at your disposal. But how does the rest of the operation work?
So our volunteers do give their time freely, which makes our model really efficient and eminently scalable. We in turn raise money for the professional staff who are very practiced at finding and recruiting adults to participate in the program, making sure that they are prepared appropriately for the work we're asking them to do, and correspondingly finding the right children and families. If you think about the span of need, some families may be facing a need that would exceed the ability of our typical volunteer to make a difference. Right. So we have to be careful that we're finding just the right children and families. And then we have to make great matches if we want them to last and for kids to have impact. And there's a tremendous amount of work that goes into finding just the right adult for each child.
So let's talk about how an organization like yours is funded. Beyond the mentors who are volunteering their time, you have an operation to manage. Talk about how you develop the resources for that operation and what those resources are used for.
Sure. So our operation is very lean and mean because, again, our service is really provided by the volunteer who's giving of their time. So our staff are there to recruit volunteers, to make wonderful matches, to support those matches so they last as long as possible. And then clearly we need a team to raise money to support that staff. And we don't ask for fees for our service. We don't get generally government money. So we're 99.9% supported by individuals, and that's through things like galas and golf tournaments, but mostly through individual giving and major gifts.
Individual contributors, and that money goes to things like your recruiting of volunteers.
Correct.
They go to the administrative infrastructure of managing all these programs. You have a website, so you have a communication function.
Sure.
You have a finance function.
Mm-hmm.
In terms of your operating expense, how much is absorbed in terms of operating costs on an annual basis?
This year it'll be $6 million in net revenue, mm-hmm. and we'll be serving just about 2,000 children.
So you also mentioned that the need is about 30,000
right.
as opposed to 2,000. How do you make a determination that who gets served of the 30,000? Because
right.
that must be a very difficult and in some respects heartbreaking process.
Sure. There's always more need than most nonprofits can meet. So our job is to stretch our donor dollars as far as they can go and serve as many children as possible with the resources we have. So we look for efficiencies in everything that we do. We look to recruit volunteers as efficiently as possible and are always exploring and experimenting with ways to drive that cost down. We look to make and support matches as, again, efficiently as possible, to raise money as efficiently as possible. We constantly have experiments going to try to find cheaper, more effective ways to do what we do.
And how did you get involved in this?
I was in media and marketing, product marketing, and then most recently in the internet and tech space.
Mm-hmm.
And I had a little bit of success in the internet tech space personally and could afford to make some slightly different decisions in my life. And I was approaching midlife. And it occurred to me that I'd like to do something with the back half that was more meaningful to me personally and hopefully would make more of a difference in the world. So I set about consulting for a while to get my feet wet and really understand the sector, see if my skills would have validity. And realized on that journey that for someone like me who wanted to be working with a team of great professionals, I was going to need an organization that was probably about $5 million and up. And I knew I wanted to work in the area of youth, and I was very fortunate to find a role with Big Brothers Big Sisters.
Do you find there's a big difference in terms of the professionalism that you encounter, or do you find that it's just a different type of professionalism?
That may have been the case at some point in the nonprofit sector's trajectory, but today the people that I work with personally and my colleagues in other organizations are top-notch professionals, as great as any professionals I ever worked with in the for-profit sector. I think you have to be. These jobs are incredibly demanding. You have to bring a full suite of skills, and you're using every one of those skills every day. This is not for the faint of heart or folks who really aren't in it to win it.
And it's interesting how you evolved into your position. You first accumulated some experience until you understood the environment in which you were entering. It is as strategic a move as if you were undertaking any career change.
Sure. It's as strategic, and you have to do the same kind of homework. Just because you have a resume built for a particular career path and it may have fantastic success and be filled with wonderful metrics and achievements.
Competencies in this area.
Doesn't mean
you have competencies in that area.
That it's going to translate. You have to find the way to translate that resume into a meaningful nonprofit story.
And the teams that you've worked with, are they mostly people who have built their careers in the nonprofit sector, or are they people who have built more diverse careers?
A real mix. And I think maybe a decade ago that transition was just beginning of people in for-profit believing that nonprofit could be a real career choice. And increasingly there are MBA programs with, you know, nonprofit management as a discipline. It's much less unusual to find someone with for-profit experience today than it was a while ago.
How does your board function? Is it mostly a fundraising board, or do they get involved in the actual programs themselves?
Mostly a fundraising and fiduciary board, and I think any nonprofit at about our size, 6 million and up, that's very much the case, especially in human service.
Well, it's a great story, and thank you so much, Wendy Foster, for sharing your experiences with us, the work of Big Brothers Big Sisters of Massachusetts Bay, and thank you for your insights.
Thank you, Mark.